Welcome back. Since its inception as an independent political entity, Kuwait has witnessed a unique coexistence among different orientations and religions. So that Kuwait was and still is the land of peace that was brought together Muslims with Christians, even with Jews at one time. And here we are on the verge of Ramadan, the month of mercy, forgiveness, and tolerance, a month that is celebrated by the people residing in the state of Kuwait soil, whether Muslims or none. Today we are pleased to highlight the value and significance of religions, tolerance, and coexistence between religions and how Kuwaiti and her people reflects those values. So it's our pleasure to have Ahmed al-Rumh, the Friday Khatib in English mosques in the state of Kuwait. Good evening, sir, and thank you so much for being with us. And barak alayk al-shahr.
Good evening. Alayna wa alayk. Jazakumullah khair.
It's our pleasure to have you here. So this is a very delicate situation because people, other places, other worlds, they cannot live together. But alhamdulillah, thank God, we have this privilege in the state of Kuwait. We are living together peacefully and in harmony. So first of all, religious tolerance is one of the main characteristics of Islam. And not to mention the state of Kuwait, the peoples of the state of Kuwait, they have the same features. Could you elaborate on that?
Assalamu alaikum. Alhamdulillah, salatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. Thank you very much for this interview. I like to mention, subhanAllah, because I have experience with people who visit Kuwait. Many people, maybe most of them, when they visit Kuwait, they like to live in Kuwait. Why? Because they have the freedom to practice their religion, specifically the Muslims, American, from Europe, from India, from East, from West. They like to live in Kuwait. And they like to die in Kuwait, subhanAllah. Why? Because they have the masajid, Ramadan, the Eid, subhanAllah, something fantastic. About tolerance in Islam, no doubt, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. And we have not sent you, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, except as a mercy to the worlds, not only to the believers, to the worlds. SubhanAllah. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the Quran, وَقُولُوا لِلنَّاسِ حُسْنَى. Say to people, not only to the Muslims, to people, good. It means good words. So subhanAllah, Islam is the religion of peace, tolerance, okay? The ease, subhanAllah, in Islam. And that's why people loved the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even the non-Muslims. They loved the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And here in Kuwait, alhamdulillah, you can see people when they, for example, they visit the Grand Mosque, they visit our masajid are open.
That's wonderful to say, because this is what I want you to be more specific on this issue in particular. How did the state of Kuwait and its people, the Kuwaiti, the natives people, coexist with the others? Because the others, they have different values, different beliefs. They believe something we don't, and it's vice versa, but still we are living together. How did they manage to do that?
Alhamdulillah.
You mentioned something about visiting the Grand Mosque. This is something... It's not an easy thing to do.
Yes, and not only the Grand Mosque. Even in the masjid where we give the Jum'ah khutbah, have three masajid in Kuwait for English khutbah. The masajid are open for anyone. If they like to attend, to listen, to see what the Muslims do in the Jum'ah. Even the iftar, especially in Ramadan, we have the iftar program in the masajid every Saturday. Okay, they can come and they can see. It is open. You can eat free in the masajid, in our masajid. Not only the English-speaking masajid, all the masajid in Kuwait. So alhamdulillah, in Kuwait, they have the freedom to attend and to see the reality of Islam. The peace, the tolerance in Islam. They can come and visit the Grand Mosque and all the masajid in Kuwait. They are open for them to see
not
Islam.
Not only in Ramadan. The whole Adam year around.
Yes, the whole year.
Now, Islam is the faith of moderation. People misunderstand that. They think that Islam is something else evil because they have a provocation for killing, provocation of doing something, violence. And this is not true because they misread the Holy Quran. So your job is to interpret every verse in the Quran and to explain to people that this is not what we are. The people who are killing somebody else out there in the world, they do not represent Islam.
SubhanAllah.
And this is more responsibility on you, specifically in Ramadan.
SubhanAllah. You remind me, one of the doctors here in Kuwait, he is Muslim, alhamdulillah, but his parents non-Muslims. So I gave khutbah about to treat your parents kindly. After the khutbah, he started to cry. And also during the khutbah, he was crying. Why? Because I mentioned what Allah mentioned in the Quran. وَإِنْ جَاهَدَاكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُشْرِكَ بِي مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِي عِلْمٍ فَلَا تُطِعْهُمَا وَصَحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. It doesn't mean that your parents are non-Muslims. It doesn't mean that you don't help them.
Nope.
So I mentioned the khutbah. You have to help them. You have to serve them. Of course, in the halal things, the halal things.
Obedience.
Yes, you have to obey your parents. Mm-hmm. Okay. Of course, we should not obey them in the haram things, nope. In the not allowed things. But mm-hmm. you have to, for example, if she needs medicine, if she needs food, if she needs money. He was crying during the khutbah and also after the khutbah. So this is the reality of Islam. It means moderation, justice mm-hmm. in Islam, al-adl, justice. And this is very important in Islam. So it doesn't mean that I kill the non-Muslims. Okay. I have to treat with them very well. A great hadith, the Prophet ﷺ had a Jew servant. He was Jew, non-Muslim. He was his servant, alayhi salatu wasalam. He became sick and the Prophet ﷺ visited that servant. He was a boy, a Jewish boy. Can you imagine that the Prophet ﷺ had a Jew servant and he visited him when he was sick? And also another lady gave the Prophet ﷺ gift, food, and she put the poison. He accepted that gift from that Jewish lady. So this is the justice in Islam, the good manners in Islam, the good behavior in Islam. The Prophet ﷺ wants to attract people to Islam. He wants the people to love Islam, not to show them, wallahi, we want to kill you, we want to finish everyone non-Muslims. Our job, to make people love Islam. If they don't embrace Islam, at least we should make them to love Islam.
There's no doubt about that, but I want you to explain to our viewers the difference between religious tolerance and religious coexistence.
Yes, coexistence, as I mentioned, in Medina society, they were not only the Muslims. Mm-hmm. As I mentioned, the Jews were with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He used to deal with them, selling, buying. Subhanallah, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam died, He took something from a Jew, not from the companions. Some scholars said, to show to them it is allowed to deal with the non-Muslims. I buy and I sell, no problem with them. And as I mentioned, his servant was a Jew, alayhi salatu wasalam. So we live with them and there are rules for them. And there are limitations. And also when they live with us, we have to protect them. This is a must. We have to protect them. And the Prophet ﷺ mentioned a dangerous hadith, okay, that if you kill a mu'ahad, what's the name mu'ahad? The one who has, nowadays like visa, who entered the Kuwait, the Muslim country, in a legal way. We have to protect them. And if you kill him, the Prophet ﷺ said, you will not smell the fragrance of the paradise from 40 years. And tolerance is something that we have to be soft with and kind with people generally, as I mentioned. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ For the mankind, not only for the Muslims. Of course, the Muslims have more rights, but also the non-Muslims, also they have their rights.
In order for you to be successful in your field, which is khatib and imam masjid that speaks English for the non-speaker of the Arabic language, you have to have books to support your claim, like the Islam is the faith of tolerance. Do you have enough books to support your story so people will convinced and be persuaded for exactly what you're saying?
Yeah, alhamdulillah, relatively now we have much
books.
More books.
Okay.
If you compare 20 years back, because now the internet and alhamdulillah many people
it's
work
an
for
open
Islam.
Field. Anybody can
work for Islam.
And read
but still we need.
Want.
Still we need. Why? Because a lot of people need to know what is Islam, mm-hmm. subhanAllah.
You do. Do you have some kind of references that you resort to support your story? Like probably a famous imam who has a certain book which explains the verses 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and etc. in the Quran.
We have the translated books, mm-hmm. translated tafsir books. We usually the English speaking scholars they translate the books. Why? Because we have enough books in Arabic for great scholars. So usually no need to write in English a book of tafsir. We need to translate. Mm-hmm. So basically we need to translate. Because we have a lot of books and you can't trust these scholars.
Perfect. I want to, Sheikh Ramh, in Ramadan, people exert more worship to get more deeds in Ramadan because everything is doubled. When you do something good, it will be doubled. And you do something bad, unfortunately, also will be doubled. So I believe that you have an Islamic da'wah activities in Ramadan. You have some kind of a strategy that you would love to do it in Ramadan to increase the awareness of Islam and to increase the followers. So do you have anything in particular during the holy month of Ramadan?
Yes, alhamdulillah, I have some halqa, some classes in Ramadan, of course in English and in the masjid. And I like to focus in Ramadan about on the Quran. The explanation of some surah, the short surah in Ramadan, and the issues related to the surah of Quran, the chapters of the Quran. And also in Kuwait, we have many associations, and they work more in Ramadan. SubhanAllah, I like one of them, the one in the screen. Mashallah, when I attended, more than, I think, 5,000 people attended in school in half a day. So we have a lot of associations, and mashallah, many of them invite me for giving lectures, giving talks. And as I mentioned, the iftar, and there is a pre-iftar talk. Why? Because people, now they are waiting for the food, and they will concentrate on the lectures. Okay, so these are the lectures in the masajid, and also, you know, on TV, alhamdulillah, I have some lectures.
What about the new generation? This is the final question. What about the new generation, the youngsters, the people who are living inside the internet and Instagram and Snapchat and stuff like that? People, they get influenced so easily. Your job and your colleagues, they have a kind of a burden on their shoulders to explain what Islam is all about, the tolerance and the forgiveness.
SubhanAllah, the non-Arab Muslims, what I found, mashallah, they like to learn Quran more. We have classes.
That's
for
a blessing.
Yes. SubhanAllah, we have something that people feel jealous toward us, we as Arabs. It is very easy for us to read the Quran, to read the Hadith. And they like to read one sentence, but it is difficult for most of them. So what I found here in Kuwait, alhamdulillah, also we have classes for the boys. We teach them the Quran, the Tafsir, the Hadith, the Fiqh. MashaAllah, they like to learn Quran. They like to learn Quran, how to, the tajweed, how to pronounce the verse in a correct way. And also we teach them how to, what is the reality of Islam, the tolerance in Islam. We have to show the people what is the real Islam, the great attitude of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You have to attract the people by your behavior before your words. This is very, very important. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهُ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ. SubhanAllah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a good example for us. So also the same thing, we should be a good example. So we are teaching our boys, you have to be a good example for others, especially for the non-Arabs. They are in schools and they are also non-Muslims. Let them ask what is Islam. Let them see the Islam in your attitude, your behavior.
Well said, Sheikh Ahmed Al-Ram. Thank you so much for being with us. It is a pleasure to have you specifically in these holy and Al-Ayyam Al-Mubarakah. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you very much.
We would like to thank Mr. Ahmed Al-Ram. He's a Sheikh, a Friday Khatib in English Mosque in the state of Kuwait. Before I leave, I would like to remind you that Sheikh Ahmed and I, really, honestly, we thank God that we live in the state of Kuwait, the state of tolerance, harmony, and peace. Not only that, everybody is living peacefully, otherwise we would never coexist because we have the church, the mosque, and everybody else goes to their own faith. So, inshallah, we will keep this attitude and behavior. And this is the end of the line for me here, right here in the state of Kuwait, and specifically the program that you've been waiting for all week long, To the Point. Make sure to join me next time, next Wednesday. Until I see you again, take care of yourself and each other, and barak alaykum inshallah. Bye-bye.